As a small rural school, we are in need of donations to achieve our goals. A donation form is therefore conveniently located in your program. So please help us to move towards more sustainability here on campus. If you are deciding you don't want to take either both the form and the program, or either or home, please remember to recycle the program outside in our commingled recycling bins. And now please lend me your hands to welcome Sister Peg Albert, President of Siena Heights University, who will officially open the event.
About our environment and what we can do to sustain it more fully. Tonight, the lecture series is endowed by Kathy and Daryl Issa in memory of their nephew, William, who was very committed to the environment and also sustainability of the environment. So I'm very grateful to them for their support. We asked them to help us build the building, and they said no, they wanted to endow a lecture series on sustainability, so that's exactly what we did. And I'm so pleased, Tom, I'm not the only one raising money around here, so so thank you. David, we are so pleased and honored to have you among us tonight. You are so renowned in your field, and you have done so much already, and we're extremely grateful to you for all that you do. It's people like you who preach. We're a Dominican institution. We are an order of preachers, and we welcome other preachers into our midst. And so we're glad that you are here tonight to teach us, to preach to us, and to enable us to and encourage us to make changes where we need to make changes. So I'm sure you would much rather tonight hear from David than me. So I will end, and just know that you're always welcome here at Siena. At least. And now John Grace is going to do our prayer. Thank you, John.
So back in the 80s, I was in an argument with somebody about the environment and nuclear weapons. And this person actually worked for the government, the United States government, and said to me, "Well, you're a real Christian, aren't you?" I said, "I hope so. I love Jesus. I try and follow Jesus, so that makes me a Christian." "Well, if you're a real Christian, you wouldn't worry about the environment. After all, we're just passing through this space, and it will be consumed in fire anyway." The only people concerned about the environment are tree-hugging humans. Unfortunately, in the religious world, that's still there, alive and well and kicking. And then we have this short guy from Rome coming in and making a very profound statement about the morality issues involved with the community. Morality issues in terms of the human community as it engages in a life within creation itself. Now, we're a Catholic institution, so I'm sure you already know this, but a big part of Catholic morality is the notion of the common good. Our ethics are shaped by it, that the values are that every single human person has value, intrinsic value, and that value needs to be respected. That all our choices are for the social well-being and the development of communities in which that individual can flourish, that we are called to extend peace, stability, and security to all. In other words, my personal moral choices are tied to your well-being. I can't say it's just up to me. I own this. That's, you see, Father, in confession if you do that. We call that sin. When I ignore the common good of the community. Pope Francis is an encyclical. This is all over the place about the moral good. And he basically speaks about we are not separated from creation. If you read it, even lightly, you will see things like a relationship and a connection that we all share. I love some of the things that he wrote, and I want to share with you. He says toward the end of it, we must regain the conviction that we need one another, that we have a shared responsibility for others, that the world and that being good and decent is worth it. But in paragraph 231, look this one up. He talks about another ethic that is so important. He talks about love. Now, in your world as undergrads, love means a certain thing in terms of attraction and personal relationships. But Pope Francis talks about love as what guides our politics, our economics, and our pursuit of the common good. He basically says this, love overflowing with small gestures of mutual care is also civic and political, and it makes itself felt in every action that seeks to build a better world. Love for society and the commitment to the common good are outstanding expressions of charity, which affects not only relationships between individuals, but also macro relationships that are social, economic, and political. He talks about the ideal of a civilization of love, a culture of care. As we begin to reflect on this with our speaker, let us put it in the context of the greater good that God intends. We are not here to analyze the dynamics of nature, but rather to explore how we fit and are part of a wonderful interwoving of creation itself. If I can't respect you, I certainly cannot respect nature. Likewise, as I respect you in love, I want to respect creation, and I want to be an advocate for it. The Pope at the end of his encyclical gave two prayers. One, a Christian prayer, and two, a prayer that includes everyone. For his encyclical was addressed to every human being on planet Earth. That is the prayer I will use tonight. Let us pray. All-powerful God, you are present in the whole universe and in the smallest of your creatures. You embrace with your tenderness all that exists. Pour out upon us the power of your love that we might protect life and beauty. Fill us with peace that we may live truly as sisters and brothers, harming no one. O God of the poor, help us to rescue the abandoned and forgotten of this earth, so precious in your eyes. Bring healing to our lives, that we may protect the world and not prey on it, that we might sow beauty, not pollution and destruction. Touch the hearts of those who look only for gain at the expense of the poor and the earth itself. Teach us to discover worth of everything, to be filled with awe and contemplation, to recognize that we are profoundly united with every creature as we journey towards your infinite light. We thank you for being with us each day. Encourage us, we pray, in our struggle for justice, for love, and peace. Amen.
Amen.
Hello, my name is Dr. June Sergi, and it is my pleasure to introduce to you our featured speaker. Dr. David Orr is a Paul Sears Distinguished Professor of Environmental Studies and Politics at Oberlin College. There, he helped to launch the Green Campus movement by organizing the construction of one of the greenest college buildings in North America, as well as pioneering a college carbon neutrality pledge, which has been adopted by hundreds of institutions worldwide. For his accomplishments, he has earned many accolades, including the Millennium Leadership Award from Global Green, the Bioneers Award, the National Wildlife Federation Leadership Award, and the Lyndhurst Prize. This evening, Dr. Orr will both challenge and inspire us with his presentation. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to Dr. David Orr.
So let me begin. This is nothing new. We have to wrestle with why we have been so slow to come to this issue. We've had warnings before. There's a wonderful book by Nicole Krauss called The History of Love. And it's the story of, in part, of a Polish village in the path of the German onslaught in 1939. And she says that there were rumors of unfathomable things. And because we couldn't fathom them, we didn't believe them until it was too late and we had no choice. There's something about us as humans that is sometimes resistant to obvious kinds of things. And the screen has a warning that was written by 102 Nobel laureates and signed by 1,500 or so scientists of some note, and published in 1992. It's a long, it's only an excerpt from it, but it's a long warning, and as far as I know, that never made the New York Times. It never made our national papers. In 2005, when Terri Schiavo was brain dead in a Florida hospital, the front page of the New York Times had her story
but you had to turn to page 8 to find a story done by a team, an international team of biologists, saying the biological diversity, the biosphere, was collapsing. And hard day, that was page 8. And on that night that it appeared, it didn't make ABC or CBS or NBC, of course it never would make Fox. So we're recalcitrant to science. And I want to come back to that theme a little bit. And one of the problems is how do we tell the news? How many of you have seen A Few Good Men? All right, great. If you haven't seen it, see it. It's a great movie. And one of the highlights of the movie, this is one of the real highs in American cinematography. Jack Nicholson is a young attorney, a young JAG attorney. He's got a case. He tries military cases. Jack Nicholson is on the stand, the commandant of the Marine Corps base where there's been a particularly egregious murder. And Cruz is losing the case. He has one last chance. It's a Hail Mary. And he throws it. He's got to provoke Nicholson, the commandant, into self-incrimination. So in a very provocative question, Nicholson finally breaks. And he says in the great words, "You can't handle the truth." Remember that line? He says it better than I do. There is a viewpoint there. There is a viewpoint. T.S. Eliot, the great American English poet, Bert Norton says humankind can't bear much reality. The other side of the screen here, Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of Britain. The bombs falling on London in 1940. London's in flames. German blitzkrieg. The city was massively affected, but it didn't break their spirit. Churchill did not go on BBC, however, and say, this is a great time for us to rebuild London. Urban renewal. The Germans are helping us here. We can finally build the London that Christopher Wren wanted us to build back in 1666 after the Great London Fire. And he said, what he said was that I don't have a thing to offer you but blood and toil and tears and sweat. Now, this divides us. Can we handle the truth? And the difference here, apart on climate change, this will come here in the next slide or two. Churchill was summoning people to wartime duty. Wars last typically 3 or 4 years. So in our case, in Afghanistan, it's much longer, but typically they're fairly short. And so we're pretty good at maintaining intensity for a short period of time. And then it goes away. How are we with climate change in this, what James Howard Kunstler calls the long emergency? So that's part of the issue. And so messaging becomes really important. This is Reverend Millstone's sermon board down here on the right, and you get some sense of how his parishioners regarded the message. Can you read this all right? The message board. You're announcing a sermon, "Are We All Prostitutes?" And you can infer what the sermon was about. We are all prostitutes, so he's being ushered out. There's some ways you don't say things to some people. And the issue is, how do we motivate people for that long-term effort ahead? Mark Twain put it this way, that when you're in doubt, we're caught between Jack Nicholson and Tom Cruise and Churchill. When we're in doubt, tell the truth, it amazes your friends, and confounds your enemies. And we're also enjoined, I think as Pope Francis said more clearly than anyone else really has in a long time, to tell the truth about the situation we're in, the whole truth, including the moral aspects of it. This is part of the truth, and it's the truth that scientists face every day. One of the things I do in the morning when I get up, one of the first things I do is to go to the science press and find out what was being said yesterday. And so it's oftentimes pretty grim reading. There isn't a lot of good scientific news, and we can dismiss it. We can deny this, but if we do, it comes to our peril. This is the climate map through September of this year. This year, as Brian will see in just a moment, as the hottest year by far ever recorded. The recordings go back to about 1880. And there are reasons for this, and we're the cause of it. But this is what the climate map looks like. And here's what the temperature average is. The top line here in white is the temperature this year. It's running hotter by far than any previous year recorded. This is not a debate. This isn't debated on Fox News. This isn't debated anywhere. This is simply the science of Earth. One of the great things that's happened in Earth system science is we can now take the temperature of the Earth with remarkable accuracy. Probably as accurate almost as we take the temperature of the human body. This is what's at stake. We tend to think of this as turning the thermostat up on the planet, but everything else would stay the same. Naomi Klein's book last year, this changes everything, it captures the essence of it. This does change everything, whatever your assumptions are, about the biota, about your life, about careers, about economy, about politics, this is going to change everything. And it will be progressive change. Now, I don't want to get into a lot of science, because we've got more important things, frankly, to do later in the talk. But you better understand this. And the two curves at the bottom, the two lines at the bottom, one is the carbon dioxide curve, the other is the temperature curve of the planet. You can also put methane or CH4 on there, and they roughly track each other. Now, you get a lot of things wrong over the course of your life and career and so forth, but you can't get that wrong. You have to understand this. If you're a student, if you don't understand this in a lot of ways and rather deeply, you've got a lot of trouble ahead that you will never understand. So this is the start of thinking about your life and your career and your moral obligations, as Pope Francis would have us do. Now, I don't want to say a whole lot here, but you can take this record back. If you weaken the standards of scientific evidence a little bit, you can take it back to inferential data that goes back well over a million years. And we know that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere hasn't gone above 280 or 290 parts per million. That's been basically the background level for a long, long time. Way back further, yes, it did. But we weren't around on the planet. So while we've been on the planet as an identifiable species for, let's call it, 200,000 years, this has roughly been a very stable period of time, particularly in the last 10 or 12,000 years we call the Holocene. So that's the period of time when we became what we became. All our highs, our lows, our wars, our poetry, everything that we've done as humans, that we record as historical data, achievements, our highs and lows, that happened in the Holocene. But we're now driving ourselves out of the Holocene. Now, the temperature we're headed toward, the other day we were coming up on the Paris climate meetings. The temperature, according to the woman in charge of the climate division at the United Nations, has the temperature going up not less than 2.3 degrees centigrade, probably more like 2.7 degrees, and that takes an awful lot of luck. And if you average out all the climate pledges currently and simply extrapolate those over a period of time, it probably goes up to 3.5 degrees centigrade. Now, here's where, and I don't want to get any farther into the weeds here, but this is what you have to understand. This is like playing Russian roulette. And the people who are the adults you look up to have, by and large, this generation been playing Russian roulette on the planet you are going to live on. 3.5 degrees centigrade, not Fahrenheit now, but centigrade. 3.5 degrees centigrade. And what happens with that? Well, sea levels are rising. They're rising faster than anybody thought, even a couple of years ago. Jim Hansen, probably the best climate scientist on the earth, this past summer published a 160-page research report with other scientists. And it is not out of the picture, it's plausible, that sea level rise in the east coast of the United States could be as much as 10 feet by the middle of the century. 10 feet. You do the math. What happens to New York City, Boston, Savannah, Miami, New Orleans, all those coastal cities? About 140 coastal cities are in the crosshairs of very large changes. And that is irrelevant. That's just remorseless working big numbers. That's carbon in the atmosphere, that's heat. Now, there is a difference when we burn carbon, what comes out of our smokestacks in our tailpipes. There's roughly a 30-year lag between what comes out of our smokestacks and tailpipes and the climate change-driven weather effects that we see. We're not good at this. That's procrastination. So we're not seeing all the weather anomalies of 2018, and they've been global. There are droughts, windstorms, earlier and larger fires in the West Coast of the United States, larger drought in California. That's not a result of 400 parts per million where we are now. That's a result of what we did 30 years ago. You follow this? Do you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. There is a lag effect. We're not seeing the consequences of what we're now doing. We're seeing the consequences of what happened 30 years ago. And that 30 years will shrink to 20 years as oceans warm, and as they become more acidic, they'll absorb less carbon. Now, this gets into a whole lot of science, and it's harder to be a good citizen in a democracy now. Because if you are, you have to listen to the debate, what was called a debate last night for the Republican Party. It won't be called a debate when the Democrats get together. You have to now understand things that you didn't have to understand 20 or 30 years ago. You have to understand Earth system science a bit, enough to see what's at stake. You've got to understand disease. You've got to understand more about science and how it impacts virtually everything else that we do. What happens as this arrow comes out here? Well, and this, by the way, there's nothing controversial on that slide. Not a thing. That's simply the science. And this comes from people who have to study climate for a living. And they have to live by the rigors of peer review, fact, data, logic, or they don't eat. This isn't coming from television. It's not coming from Rush Limbaugh. This is coming from people who have to make a living by being accurate and being correct and having their facts, data, and numbers checked by other science. It's called science. And so there's nothing controversial, but we don't know exactly where we're headed. Now, one other thing I want to point out. This isn't a matter that's settled. The wild card in this deck are called carbon feedback cycles. So the warmer it gets, the greater the chance of releasing methane, which is locked up in boreal forests in the north, in what are called methane clathrates and seabeds. Methane is molecule for molecule, 20 or 25 times more potent as a greenhouse heat-trapping gas than carbon dioxide is. So, and there are other heat-trapping gases. There's sulfur hexafluoride, there are a lot of nitric oxides, there are lots of other things that trap heat. The sum total of all of these is called CO2e. It's CO sub 2 sub e. And what that means is that if you take all these other heat-trapping gases and render them roughly equivalent to carbon dioxide, we come up with a much higher number. Instead of 400 parts per million, we go to 450 to 470. But now remember, the background rate is 280 parts per million. That's what we've come through. We've never been here as a species before. It is hotter on the planet, it will be hotter on the planet, than it has been any time since we've been on this planet. Now make of it what you will, but it will affect every one of you in this room. It affects all of us in the future. Now, let me say one other thing about this. What you're seeing is a slide, and our biology has tricked us. Done us no particular favors. Our biology causes us to see that as simply colors. The blue could be a little different shade of blue, the red could be a little bit different, the slide could be organized. So we see that as simply an object that doesn't cause us any particular physiological response. Nobody in this room, I'll bet, looked at that and went, oh my God. Heartbeat went up? No. Sweaty palms? Nobody in this room has sweaty palms. But I'll tell you this. If I reach down here and I pull out an Uzi, I kind of stroll out here casually with a slightly wild look at my face, I'll have your attention the way that slide doesn't get it. Because what kicks in is your fight-flight mechanism. All of a sudden, I've tapped into your amygdala, the fear cell, and we are good. Human beings have been honed by predators for years. So if it's hairy and long teeth or dependably loathsome like Osama bin Laden or Adolf Hitler, we're pretty good. You follow what I'm saying? So if we can project hatred onto an object or fear in that object, we're good. That's how we've survived over the years. We haven't survived by having to think about this. And this is long term. This means that if we were going to avoid the worst of what we now will face, we should have started 30 or 40 or 50 years ago. A long time ago. We missed that opportunity. The first warning of a US president about this came in 1965. Lyndon Johnson heard it and he gave it. And we knew about climate change, the science was emerging from 1898 on to the present. We knew that carbon dioxide from the combustion of fossil fuels, coal, oil, natural gas, was going to change climate. And we knew about that with increasing precision. And so as the decades went on, this science began to emerge, and it is irrefutable. With heat trapping gases in the atmosphere, they will trap heat. Put a lot up there, it'll trap a whole lot of heat. Now again, you get a lot of things wrong in this life, but you can't get that wrong. We cannot get this wrong as a civilization and have any chance of surviving the next century. So time is really short. It is not our friend. Let's move on. This is where we're headed. These are numbers that are now pretty current. The path as we can project it, the business as usual, will take us to 4.5 degrees centigrade warming. And that's centigrade, not Fahrenheit. It's much more. 4, 9 fifths plus 32. The best we can do is to try to bring this to 2 degrees centigrade warming. Now, just for numbers, we're already at 0.9 degrees centigrade. That's where we are at this point. We've already warmed the planet almost 1 degree. What is in the pipeline, however, is another roughly 0.4 degrees centigrade to 7 or 0.8 degrees centigrade. That's already happened. We're already committed now to another at least 0.5 degrees centigrade warming. So that's simply where we're headed. Now, this is probably the hardest thing for us as Americans to get. Americans, we think ourselves as problem solvers, and we're good at that. So if you've got a busted carburetor on a Chevy pickup truck, you know, we can solve that problem. Got to run a bridge from this side to that side of a river, we're really good at it. We've done amazing things. What David Archer, who is a climate physicist, says here is kind of standard science. The carbon dioxide that we put in the air today, wherever you drove, and the lane I drove over here from Logan, Ohio, and all the CO2 that came out of our tailpipe, will, a portion of it will still be in the atmosphere 1,000 years from now. 20 to 22% of it will be in the atmosphere 10,000 years from now. You follow what I'm saying? This is a long-term problem, hence the phrase the long emergency. Now, there are things we can do. I want to get back to that in just a moment. But let's not kid ourselves. This doesn't get down easy with Americans. This defies our optimism. Now, a couple of people, a couple of responses on you. If people say they don't believe this stuff, the word belief is the wrong word. If I say, do I believe in Jesus or Moses or Buddha, that's where belief applies. But this is just physics and chemistry. That's all it is. And then the social and economic and political implications of what we do to the world physically. So if somebody comes up to you and says, gee, I don't believe in the laws of gravity, a real quick and easy test for that. Come to the top of the building with me and let's check it out. But they don't say that. And it's interesting, at this particular point, on the stage last night were seven men and one woman, who by and large deny everything about climate change. They deny the science. But if they feel the pains of a heart attack coming on, they will want the best science money can buy. If it's their life at stake, they're going to want the best science, medical sciences available. But if it's merely the health of the planet, they're willing to take it to Rush Limbaugh or the Lord knows who. But you see the discrepancy? We have so mangled this debate nationally, and people will die because we delay this. This is not a joking matter. This is something we have to get right. Pope Francis was exactly correct. I wish it was climate change is the only thing. Now, this is a graphic that we don't need to dwell on, but what you see here, this is taken out of Nature magazine. Nature is the British equivalent of science in the United States. These are the two most distinguished general all-purpose science publications in the world. And what they've done in this is to mark out the green space as the safe operating space for humankind. And then around here are a series of ecological, climatological variables. Climate change, biological diversity, and nitrogen, and so forth. These are the things that we know in red, where we've already exceeded the safe carrying capacity of the planet. You don't hear about this on television much. I mean, you go on specials, you can find this, but this has not been part of the national dialogue. Our generation, after roughly 5,000 generations of humans and human form, our generation is the one in the past 50 years that has violated virtually all the safe space on the Earth. Some of this we don't know yet. Some is trending in the wrong direction. Some we don't keep data on. But if you were on an airplane, call it planet Earth, and you're in the, say, the cockpit, this is going to be on your dashboard. you're gonna see something like an altimeter and alarms beginning to go off. These red are alarms going off very loudly. And we don't have to do a whole lot here. One of those is enough to end civilization. Just one. So we've got to get these things back in some semblance of order. The debate now going on about sustainability is all more or less, whatever that means, is about that chart. How do we begin to rein in these large, remorseless, big numbers and inhabit this planet in a way that's fair and decent and durable and resilient? Before I get to the heart of the thing, let me also explain this. If you get into this very far, and as a younger person, even as an older person I am, you find yourself very angry at what's happening. ExxonMobil knew in 1977, we know for a fact now, what the burning of their primary product would do to the Earth. But this would cut into their profits, they figured. And so they lied about it. Their own interior science knew exactly what was going on with the combustion of fossil fuels that they own, their reservoirs. Their business plan calls for burning all of their fossil fuel reserves. And they can do that without breaking a single law now in place. They can terminate your future. Now, if you're a student here, this is your future at stake. And they will break no law by wrecking the planet that you're going to live on. And they knew this a long time ago. And if this sounds familiar, it should, because this is the tobacco lawsuit cases. It's exactly the same thing. What did they know? And when did they know? Well, it turns out they knew it a long time ago. And they'd even been talking about how much ice burning their product, this is back in the 1962 or thereabouts, how much ice did they melt? Something like 7 billion tons a day or something. And our politics have been organized around fossil fuels. This is Mitch McConnell, that's coal behind him. He's a Kentucky senator. That's a particularly egregious case. The Democrats aren't much better. There are a few who stood up. Sheldon Whitehouse from Rhode Island has been one of the seminal people in this battle. But the American political system has failed you and us and civilization. Very time we needed to do something different. Now, let me change gears. What do we do about it? In my case, this is part of the story. Trying to work at several different levels in this, but this is part of the story. In the mid-1990s, we began to work on a single building called the Adam Joseph Lewis Center. And it turned out it became my building to do because the college told me you could build a facility for the environmental studies program, but you'll have to raise all the money for it, and you can't go to any donor otherwise likely ever to give to Oberlin College. And so I used to say that left me the Columbia Drug Cartel. And the vice president for development said, no, you can't go to them, they're ours too. So anyway, what we did was to get a group of students. We said, look, if you want to be part of making a building, come on in. And so we opened the doors. We had about 250 students that came in with a series of design charrettes. A charrette is just a big planning meeting. And the question for the students was, what kind of building do you want to be educated in? Now, every room, every place you're in on an academic campus has its own curriculum. It tells a story. Where do the materials come from? Where's the flooring from? Where does the energy come from that's in the, what's in the fabric of the seats you're sitting on? Is it carcinogenic, mutagenic, or endocrine disruptors? Well, yeah, it turns out biological probably is. So we put together these 13 panels that were design charrette meetings. And down the right-hand side of the slide is essentially the building program that came out of it. Students wanted a building powered entirely by sunshine. I live in the you're sunny up here in Michigan, this part of Michigan. We get a lot of lake effect cloudiness. Sunshine in Oberlin, Ohio is kind of a theory. We've heard about it, but we don't see it. So they wanted a building that was zero discharge, drinking water in, drinking water out. That's kind of interesting. And one way to do that is put toilets in another building. But this is what they wanted. This is the kind of building they wanted. And what they were saying was, let's make a space that by the way it's designed and built and operated becomes part of the curriculum. Let's make it the way that it continually educates. So by the way the building is built and is maintained and evolves over time, then it is part of the curriculum. And you were also saying something that I think bears on John's reference to Pope Francis. They wanted a building the making of which caused no ugliness, human or ecological. at any point in time or some later time. And so if that's the standard, you've got to think upstream from this thing we call a building to wells and mines and forests and manufacturing places where building materials start to be made. And if you compromise human dignity and ecological functions upstream, you can't say it's a great building. And the same thing downstream. So if a building contributes to biotic impoverishment or climate change or contamination and spread of toxics, in all of you in the room, if you're under 40, give or take, you have probably 230 or so organochlorine compounds in your fatty tissues and bloodstream. They don't belong. It becomes your promiscuous chemistry. Nobody's fault in particular, just the way you evolved in the industry. But that's ugliness. It's human and it's ecological. So like truth, beauty, and justice, you can try to get there when you make buildings, but it's, you never quite always get there. Buildings are just buildings. So this is how we started. That is a view of a completed building taken a couple of years ago. The final building was selected by the American Institute of Architects is the most important green building in the past 30 years. It won a bunch of awards. Did a lot of things right. It's, I think I'm correct in saying this, it's still the only entirely solar-powered building on a U.S. college campus. That's in a place in the United States where sunshine, like I said, is still a theory. So, but buildings are just buildings. And what this building did was to create a curriculum around applied hope. We had the 10th anniversary of this building. A group of students came back and worked on the project. And they had started businesses. They had started a high-performance building monitoring company. They had started a farm and a restaurant business and a development company that's now down in Cleveland. It actually done things. So what this building did was to expose young people to really wild, crazy people who are doing things in the world. It's one thing to sit in classes, it's a great thing, and you've got great teachers here, and it's important. It's another thing to roll up your sleeves and have a curriculum in applied hope, or change the word applied love. If you really do love the world, what are you going to do in the world? And how do you have a career or life in it? That's the back of the building. It's about an acre and a quarter site. The building is 14,200 square feet. The cost of the building is about $7.2 million. The collateral benefits of the building were huge, including probably $40 to $50 million in gifts that came into the college because of it. Increased yield, the number of students that actually come to school, that have been accepted in school. The publicity was phenomenal. They had over 1,000 pieces of paper publicity. Interior shot. Now, let me take this on to the next step. We began to work on something called the Overlook Project. I'll say just a word about that in a moment. This is the next phase. This is a building currently under construction. So we said, if we can make a 14,000 square foot building powered entirely by sunshine in Ohio, can we do the same with a hotel and conference center? So this is a building presently under construction. This picture was taken 3 weeks ago. The left side is a conference center. The right side is a hotel with a commercial district down on the first floor. Jazz clubs down in the basement. This is a building also that will be powered entirely by sunshine. Now, part of the purpose of this building has been to connect students with what we're doing here. So students work on the design of this in a couple of classes. And then if I could show you another picture, down at the end of the block is one of the great art museums in American higher education. Ranks behind Harvard, Yale, Williams College, and Illinois. In the middle of the block is a performing arts center. And one of the difficulties I think all of us have, particularly people like me, about the sustainability is this is a big fuzzy word. Nobody really knows what it means. But it's always parts per billion, charts with a lot of complex science in it, and so forth. Can we begin to take the word sustainability? And can we, by re-emptying colleges and universities, take this word and make something of a celebration of it? And so imagine a celebration around sustainability where it mixes art, poetry, science, and celebration, and locally grown foods, and a four-star restaurant, and music, and oh, by the way, it's all powered by sunshine, and it releases no pollution. That's the plan. So can we begin to widen the conversation about sustainability? This is a project right across the street. This site was a site of an abandoned Buick dealership, a defunct dry cleaner that had spread perchloroethylene all over the site, and an abandoned fast food place. So three of my former students bought this and built three buildings on it. The third one is behind these two. It is LEED Gold rated, 33 condominiums, right across the street, right in the middle of downtown, and beginning to change the way the downtown works and bring people back into living in the downtown. Now, nobody, your generation, if you're a student here, nobody really wants to buy a 5-acre farmhead or mansion out in the suburbs. That was a better way to do it. Your generation wants to live downtown in service-rich areas where there are clubs and business and transportation, and it's an exciting place to be. And so you find downtowns everywhere. You want a downtown apartment in Detroit, for example, which otherwise is famous for decay, you have to wait about a year because that's how much demand there is for people your generation wanting to move back into Detroit. The same is true of Cleveland, Toledo, Buffalo, and so forth. So that's happening in our part of the world. These are the three students that did it. And they did it in their 20s. They graduated at age 22. They stayed in town to begin to develop this project. They now have a development company working in downtown Cleveland. But they took the ideas. They were not paralyzed by numbers. If you look at what the numbers said about climate change and all the bad news, some of which I mentioned. But this is what they've done. They started a development company that's redeveloping these old Rust Belt cities. I mean, how exciting can that be? This is another project in Oakland. This is groundbreaking for a passive solar house that is designed to be affordable by somebody at or below the poverty level. We've got a poverty level of about 28% of the Rust Belt. And so this is the final product. This is a 1,400 square foot building powered entirely by sunshine. The woman, single mother with two children, at below the poverty line, will never pay an energy bill. And so we want to show that solar power isn't just for rich people, it's also for people with very modest means and live below the poverty line. This is a another thing we've done. This is a 2.27 megawatt output solar array. It's a tracking array. It follows the sun over the course of the day, so the array actually moves. So it puts out about 3 to 3.2 megawatts of power. And by comparison, our base load in Oakland is about 11 megawatts, so roughly 3 of 11. And this, we did this 3 years ago. Had we done this past summer, the cost would have been half of what we paid for 3 years ago. And 3 years ago, it was still a good deal. So can you power a little city, can you power a building in Ohio, climate Ohio, by sunshine? The answer is yeah, you're done. Can you make a whole 105,000 square foot hotel conference center powered by sunshine? Yeah, we're doing that too. Could you power the whole city by enhanced efficiency in sunshine? The answer is yeah, you could. And so what is happening in Oakland is the college is beginning to lead in the development and redevelopment of the city. Here's what we've done to date on the Oakland project. This is a mixture of a whole lot of different things. We were selected by the White House last fall. It was one of 17 climate champion cities across the United States. We're part of the Clinton Climate Initiative. We're one of the C40 cities. We're not even a good size building in Beijing. We're one of the C40 cities. We spent about $106 million. Most of that is private investment. A little bit of the money is college, leading in various ways, but most of that is private investment. And not the least of this is the goal to begin to get 70% of our food from local farmers. So if you look at the climate change map carefully, you saw that California is not going to be a food exporting country much or state much longer. We're not going to bring in food from California at a price we can afford and the volume we need to feed our population behind. We're going to have to reinvent agriculture. You'll have to do it this thing too. So long distance food transport for a lot of crops and quantities is going to be a big advance. We're going to have to reinvent local agriculture. Well, it's kind of interesting because that's where the food market is going anyway. If you talk to chefs, the best restaurants need to buy local and just local produce, free range chickens raised locally and so forth. So two trends converge on the same result. But our goal is to have 70% of our food grown locally within the next 20 or 30 years. If we stop there and we help to revive our little town and make it a solar powered town, we'll have done nothing very important. So the next goal is to take this in some fashion, this has been harder than I thought it would be, to take this up to the regional scale. The mayor of Flint, Michigan, about Detroit here, says that His tax base falls 20% per year. That's a city in financial freefall. Detroit, we all know about. Toledo's not a whole lot better. The dinner's over. Cleveland has come back to some degree. It has all the problems that Rust Belt cities have. We grew up near Youngstown, Ohio, on the east side of Youngstown, Ohio. And Youngstown, which was the most wealthiest city per capita in the United States in 1941. Looks like the German army went through about 1943 and left ruin in its wake, and it's still there. So the question is, what can we learn from what we're doing in Oberlin that applies to the regional scale? Can we take this up to scale? And so here is the theory behind the effort. There's a very famous urban theorist died maybe 10 years ago now, Jane Jacobs. And Jane Jacobs' most famous book was one called The Death and Life of Great American Cities. But she wrote a couple books on city economics. And the point of the books was that national economies don't grow. What grows are city regions. And so Britain doesn't grow, but London does grow. And regions around cities tend to grow. They grow by a process of import substitution. So if they need something, instead of bringing in long distance, they begin to make it within the city. So our thought is that colleges and universities, of which in this region there are about roughly 25, could begin to take their buying power in food, which they buy anyway, in energy, which you buy anyway, and in infrastructure, which you build anyway. Take those monies and begin to spend them locally. Keep them within the local economy. If you're an economist or an economics course, you know that the phrase, the multiplier effect, pops up here. So money spent locally tends to stay in the local economy. If you go out to Walmart and buy something at Walmart, that dollar you spend at Walmart is down in Bentonville, Arkansas, within 24 hours. And so money leaves the local economy. Can we keep it in the local economy and keep it as a driver for economic development? So this is what we're, this is again the theory of what we're trying to do now, is to take these three things, take anchor institutions, like Siena Heights University. You're going to be here a long time. You have been here a long time. You'll be here for a much longer time. And same true of Oberlin, University of Michigan. Take anchor institutions that have a vested interest in the economy of the region and begin to change the way they buy and invest. Now, if you're looking at this, I don't know what your majors are. It doesn't matter. But your majors fit into this also. So if colleges and universities can begin to spend their money and investment and their endowment and so forth within the local economy, it rebuilds the local economy, but also for people like me and the faculty, it's a huge opportunity to begin to teach and add different kinds of research for this. The collateral benefits are huge. So think of regions beginning to redevelop. Economic development, lower crime rates, lower carbon emissions, cleaner air, better health. You can make a much longer list than this. So the collateral benefits are anchor institutions like your university, our college, other institutions around here begin to rebuild the local economy. This still is Rust Belt. We've got a lot of work to do. Now, let me end with some thoughts about your students. So the students and faculty administrators in this room, what do we do? First thing I think is to understand what we're talking about. All the disorder I talked about, all the first five or six slides, that reflects failures in how we think and what we think about. So all that ecological disorder reflects a prior disorder in between our 2 years. It's how we think and how poorly we think about a lot of things. Second thought is this. Every bit of your education, all of it, is environmental education. We're teaching you you're part of or a part from. And this is the whole point of Pope Francis. We are joined. This is a community. You're a part of life and this endeavor of life that started way back long ago and will extend far out as our imagination can take. And so we teach you by what we include or exclude that you're part of or a part of. Third thought. You will have to be competent in ways we never thought would be competent before. So here's our kind of a rough way to say this. The top part here is all the fast stuff that we pay attention to. It's sports scores, it's goofy celebrities, it's local movies, it's all the things that are on the front page of the paper or the first thing on CNN News. The bottom list are all the things that happen slowly. But they'll say more about your life and the quality of your life and your prospects than the top things do. And, of course, the trick is that those things at the bottom of it, which geochemical cycles, carbon cycles, soil loss, illiteracy, and so forth. They'll eventually be, they'll work their way out to become the headlines. They'll be on CNN, the front page of New York Times. They'll be there at some point. So what you will have to learn is to see how these slow processes, many of them ecological, the biogeochemical cycles that have to do with biological diversity, how those slow things affect everything else. It's just they don't appear on the headlines. And then there's this issue. And this kind of relates to Pope Francis. This was the cover of the New Yorker magazine. What it portrays is the New Yorker's version of an old Islamic tale called the Tale of the Jinn. And in the Tale of the Jinn, the animals in the jury box here are given voice and sentience. And the attorney is the guy in the front there. Humankind is in the dock. We're on trial. And the issue for the animals is whether humans will be allowed to survive on the planet or not. I used to have my students in a one-on-one intro of environmental studies class play the role of being the attorney for humankind. And his other students, they're Presbyterian in this sense, they just thought that humans didn't really deserve to survive. So, you know, we don't deserve to survive, so yeah, we ought to get out of here. And then stop and think about it. And you think about, we are the species that first learned the reasons why we should care for other species. Think about it. And we're the species that determine the age of the Earth and the age of the universe, as far as we can understand. And we're the species who gave life to Mozart and to Mother Teresa and to Pope Francis. We deserve to be around for a while. We'll come around to this, but the point of this slide is this. If we knew better why we deserve to be sustained, we would know better how to go about being sustained. This big word, sustainability. You follow what I'm saying? We still think of ourselves, this is very much without the scripture, we still think of ourselves as economic creatures. We're mortal. But until we understand that we are creatures made in the image of God, or however you wish to say it, will be, our efforts will be lackluster, under-well-informed, and not much more than we have done. Here's another thought. Whatever your occupation, whatever your major, join the design revolution that's happening now. The building I showed you, the Adam Joseph Lewis Center, was a design part of that design revolution. That was a building way before anybody else had done this on college campuses, powered by sunshine. We eliminated toxins, purified wastewater on site, and made the building itself an educational venture. Perfect building? No. Good building? You bet. But a building that influenced the young people and so forth, this is actually all over. If we did that building again, it'd be cheaper, better, perform a lot better. There has been a massive change in design across virtually every field you can name. So join the design revolution. Design is how we make stuff. But ecological design is how we make things that fit on a planet with a biosphere. How do we make things that fit within the moral context that Pope Francis described? And then, if I said our design fitters, but there are multiple design fitters. Our whole, all of the crises around us has been virtually all design failures. Put 1 pound of product on a store shelf, we leave behind 3,200 pounds of debris and junk and ruin. 1 pound. And that 1 pound has a bigger chance of ending up in the landfill. Follow what I'm saying? Not necessary at all. The carpet that your feet are on could have been made in a way, it wasn't, could have been made in a way that's returned back to the manufacturer and then leased back out again. We can close waste cycles. It's called industrial ecology. We now have multiple examples of places where in industry and manufacturing and marketing, we can simply eliminate virtually all waste and save money in the process. The energy and food ratio, typically it takes 11 to 70 calories depending on the food and the location. Put 1 calorie on your plate. That is a design for it. We know how to make agriculture and food systems work better than that. And we spend something like $1.3 trillion a year on something we call defense. It doesn't really work very well. But could we begin to rethink the whole design strategy of defense? That's $15,000 a second, every second, every day. Could we think, rethink the design behind this thing we call security? And could we change the word security to be defined in a way that guaranteed everybody the right to health care, to education, to safety, to shelter, to decent childhood? That's real security. And that is as secure as anything you can think of. There are design principles. nothing on this slide that surprises anyone. But if you make it powered by sunshine, protect diversity of all kinds. Pay attention to all the costs, even the smaller costs downstream or upstream. Think of the whole system. If you graduate here without being a systems thinker, demand your money back. And that's a lifelong process, but we need to be able to see whole patterns. And the essence of systems really is religion, root word for which means to bind together. And then eliminate waste. Every bit of waste ought to be food for some other process. And then for economics, you hear some people say, well, gee, we love this, we think it's great, but we can't afford it. You can't afford not to. Because we pay for sustainability, whether we get it or not. We pay when you can't get a job. We pay because of unemployment. We pay because of wasted lives. We pay in all kinds of other currencies, including health, and disease, and war, and so forth. But we pay. And the idea is somehow that we really love this stuff, but we can't afford to do it. And then we spend millions or billions or trillions of dollars on fighting war and something called security. And then all of you are graduating here understanding how to make smarter solutions, things that cause no future problems, and things that begin to work very differently. So begin to think, whatever your career plans may be, think of yourself as a problem solver, and not as a technician. There are ways to solve and tinker at the edges of problems, be a problem solver, and understand the structure of things. Be a systems thinker, Carl Heinrich Behr, an ecologist from Sweden, and begin to think about this and dealing with cancer as putting band-aids on terminal illnesses. So again, to think about cancer as a systemic property of the culture that wastes a lot, spews out chemicals every which way, creates food systems that are unhealthy and so forth, and cancer is a result of lots of other things. And then be a silo break. If we need anything now, to understand, say, Pope Francis II, you had to be able to think across all kinds of boundaries, economics, and moral, and philosophical, political and environmental, and the word integral that he used dozens of times in that statement, means begin to think about the wholeness of systems. Learn to be a silo breaker. And then I want to say a word about politics. This is our quadrennial silly political season. And I want to point out something. This is Edmund Burke. Edmund Burke was the founder, more than anybody else, of modern conservatism. And in a wonderful book written in 1790, about the same time he and Thomas Jefferson were roughly contemporaries, Edinburgh described the current generation as required as trustees, required to pass on an entailed inheritance from the distant past to the distant future. And think about that. That is the essence of responsible planetary planning. Thomas Jefferson, 2 years before, a year before, had said roughly the same thing. He said, no generation has the right to pass debt on to the generations that come after. And if you change the word debt to include not just finances, but also the ecological conditions on which every economy and every society rests. So from both the left and the right, you have agreement about essential principles. We cannot pass on debt in any form to future generations. So go back to that blue slide. That was a form of debt. That's passing on. We got the benefits of burning fossil fuels cheaply and easily. I used to have a 1964, way back a million years ago, 1964 Ford Galaxy 500 convertible, 375 horsepower, 4-barrel carburetor. I will tell you, I love driving that car. If I had it today, I'd drive it again. But that car, when you press down the accelerator, you're going pretty fast, pretty quick. But that car, and cars like it, spewed out an awful lot of greenhouse gas. It may have gotten 12 miles to the gallon. And state-of-the-art ground course is upwards of 100 miles per gallon. But think about this intergenerational transfer. We never thought about you. We didn't give you a thought in the world as we were driving our cars and building oversized buildings and using energy efficiently. So think also that the left and the right, this is a battle between liberals and conservatives. Those are both sides of the same coin. And you will be liberal in some part of your life, you'll be conservative in some part of your life. It's called a grown up. It's called being a thinking person, not a dinner man. And you begin to think about it. On some issues, you're going to be liberal. Some you're going to be conservative. As you get older, your positions will change. But it is not left versus right. There are a lot of people who make a very good living dividing us on that point. And they have no right to do that. To do that, they have to learn to use public words in very careless kind of ways. How is it that conservatism in some places became became a bad word. It's a perfectly good word. Or liberalism in some places became a bad word. It is also a perfectly good word. It means an openness to life and solutions and so forth. Conservatism means take care of what you got. You have to do both. It isn't one against the other. These are flip sides of the same coin. Be a thinking political person. And then want to end on a couple of thoughts. If you're optimistic, and you're under 25, your glands are telling you to be optimistic. The world is wild and exciting. You're going to go to Europe, and you're going to go here, and you're going to do this, or do that. That's how we've survived as a species. But if you're optimistic, you don't know it. If you're a despair, that's a sin you don't want to go to. The only rational place for us to be, is in the middle. And that's hope. And hope is the verb and the sleeves rolled up. Now, if you're optimistic, you won't do anything. If you're pessimistic and in despair, you won't do anything. The only place where you'll act is where you got hope. And in hope, you don't have hope because you think you're going to win the game. I've been a Cleveland Indians fan for all these years. I know what hope is like. Hopelessness is like. But hope is that middle position. It's where we have to be. And here are some reasons for hope. Elaine and I built a solar powered house in 1980. And it was hugely expensive. PV, whatever, you mortgage our entire future to build a thing. But here's what's happened with the price of photovoltaics. Almost everywhere, solar powered electricity has come down to the point where it is equal now. The base load of coal in most parts of this country with none of the disadvantages of burning coal. Coal is the largest source of mercury in your body and in the air pollution. We talk and knock tops off mountains in West Virginia to get at, quote, cheap coal. It has changed the climate, it has changed our air, it's changed our health, it's changed our prospects. Here's another way to do it. And here's what's happened. This is Austin, Texas. This is a 30 megawatt array, 10 times the size of what you saw build it over. This is breaking out all over. If you want to do a solar powered house, you get your order in now because the demand is so high and supply is not the result of demand. This is what's happening to solar photovoltaic capacity. It's going up worldwide. Think of where cell phones were. Well, you can't think of this because you're too young, but 25 years ago, nobody had a cell phone. Now, how many of you have cell phones? All of you have cell phones. And some of you are tweeting on them right now. So think of how fast a technology can change. This is the adoption curve of PV. Same thing is happening to wind power. And wind power is powering the country either by sunlight or by wind power combined with efficiency in the answer yet. That is a solved problem. Carbon in the atmosphere, not so solved. But could we power the society by sunshine? The answer is yes. We started in Oberlin, one little building, and then a bigger building, and now the whole city. Can you power the society by sunshine, efficiency, and a bit of ingenuity? Yeah. And we need people to understand the technology behind this. We need business people to start businesses that actually deploy these kind of technologies. We need lawyers to help write the better laws that make this easier to happen. We need an army of people like you out there doing this. Pope Francis changed the equation, I think, as Father John described so eloquently and so brilliantly. He changed the equation. All of a sudden it became acceptable for lots of people to see climate change for what it really is. It is the threat to our society. The response is integral. It's got to have moral force behind it. But it also has to have technology and people like you to roll up your sleeves and work with it. Imagine a Congress that we did get. Imagine Congress persons of whatever party. This is not an argument for Democrats or Republicans, but imagine the end of denial. It will end. 54% of Republicans, according to the Yale panel, now believe that climate change is real and humans are driving. 54%. But not one of those 8 people on the stage last night. Not yet. And not one has the moral courage to get up and say it. And then what's happening here in divestment. All across the country, student activism is changing the way we do our business in higher education. And so these have to be Harvard kids, you can have them in Oberlin, but the battle is joined on hundreds of campuses in the United States and elsewhere. Take the money that we have to invest and invest it in things that make our world better, not a world, not compromise the world that you all are going to inherit. And then there are these kids. This was a petition. They won in court to get standing in a case involving climate change. So the judge gave him standing, yes, your generation is imperiled by this, you have standing, in other words, your views matter in this particular court case. Here's the same thing that happened in The Hague earlier this year. The court here, European court, gave this group standing on the same kinds of issues. Legal standing, in other words, your voice can be heard in court. And then here's, I want to end with a couple thoughts about what you actually do. Here is a chart that's been maintained for a number of years. Data on your generation's attitudes, or generations as they come along. And you see this the switch here. It used to be that people came out of high school, wanted to go to college, university, and so forth. And the highest priority they had was to develop a meaningful philosophy of life. Imagine that. And to make money was the lower curve. Well, look how they crossed. Now, this is more complicated than the graph says, because if you graduate from Bull Run or a lot of colleges and universities, you have a lean on future income. You'll owe $20,000 or $30,000 or $40,000 to some bank someplace to pay for your college education. That is wrong, by the way. I agree with Bernie Sanders. College education ought to be free across the board, including sabbaticals for anybody every 7 years. Anyone in this country can go take a course at a college, a junior college, JV, two-year college, four-year college, university, whatever. Other two, everybody gets 6 or 7 months off every 7 years. But this is what's happening. The part of the issue here is we have not built out a big enough goal for you. So get a college before you get a career. Pope Francis singled out Thomas Merton, one of my heroes. And Merton wrote a bestseller, Seven School Mountains autobiography, fairly early in life. Became a bestseller. Columbia University, his alma mater, asked him to contribute to an issue on success and what caused him to be successful. So his words would be anything you like. This is the words he said to the magazine, tell Columbia University students, be anything you like. Be madmen, drunks, bastards of every shape and form, but at all costs avoid one thing, success. Now, here's where career counseling comes in. If we talk to you about we made a mistake. That careers will happen, but get a calling first. A good old Presbyterian Catholic word, but get a call. Find out why you're here first. Find out what makes you tick. What really is important? What makes you happy? And chances are it's not making money. Money is just a surrogate for love. If you need love, then, you know, don't look at all the wrong places, I guess. But find a way to identify your call. Find a way to find out what really is important to you. And don't settle for less. And you'll find it's not a straight line. There are very few straight lines in biology. Find people whose biographies you also admire. But if you want a career, here's a list of them. And whatever your field, you can make a much longer list, whatever your field, find a way to engage the field in your talents, and your enthusiasm, your energy and creativity, which is incredible, with the big issues of the planet. The first slides I started with, find a way to get your shoulder to that wheel. Find a way to get yourself engaged where everyone, you want to make money? Fine. Make money like Ray Anderson, the founder of Interface Carpet Corporation, became the most successful carpet salesperson in the world because he was making carpet that never went to a landfill and didn't use oil from Saudi Arabian crude oil. And so he figured out a business plan, an absolute genius. Interface Carpet Corporation pioneered a whole new way to think about business and products and so forth. And there are lots of others. If you want to win the law, win the law. One of the big issues for us right now is, what are the rights of future generations? What are the rights of the species, our fellow creatures on this earth? How do they compare with our rights? If this was an intergenerational democracy, there are going to be a whole lot more future generations than there are people living right now on the planet. So what would you want us to do? And this is a matter of law. If you want to go to teaching, great, come on in. Teach whatever you want, but teach it in a way that engages and connects young people, your students, with the world as it is. So that's my list. And then finally, let me say two so last things. It's possible, it is even probable, that we come up a dollar short a day late. And this is Martin Luther King, the year before he was assassinated. He says this, there's such a thing as being too late. Procrastination is the thief of time. Life often leaves us standing bare and naked and rejected with a lost opportunity. The tide in the affairs of man doesn't remain at the flood. It ends. We may cry out desperately for time to pause in the passage, but time is death to every plea rushes on. And over the bleached bones and jumbled residue of numerous civilizations are written the pathetic words, too late. Whatever you do, whatever your choice of a life, a calling, a career, do it with a sense of urgency. Time is not a friend at this point. The numbers tell us otherwise, and we've got to pay attention to the numbers without being paralyzed by them. And then, two last thoughts. This word sustainability, no one really knows what it means. It's a big, fuzzy word. But it's going to be a long journey. Sustainability is going to be a matter of building a few green buildings, driving a Prius, and scooping light bulbs. And for guidance on this, I think all of us in our bones kind of know what this word means. Robert Fulton wrote a wonderful book called All I Ever Needed to Know, I Learned in Kindergarten. And so here was part of his list. Play fair. Imagine American politics if fairness actually was implemented. Clean up your messes. Imagine what that would do to the oil industry. And ExxonMobil that knew in 1977 it was creating an awful mess. And it would fall on you and your children and their children. And share your cookies. You know, 400 people could easily fit them in this room. In this society, have more net wealth than the bottom 185 million people. You can put 85 million people worldwide in this room who have more net wealth than the bottom 3.7 billion people on the planet. Share your cookies. Don't take things that aren't yours, but it applies to Koch brothers or whomever, Wall Street. So just don't be a thief. And then in dangerous times, hold hands crossing the street. We know these things in our bones. This is sustainability. It's all that it means. And sustainability isn't something we strive for. Think of this as an equation. It make it clean, green, fair, and safe. And if it equals, it'll be sustainable. But you don't start with sustainability first. Be a decent human being first. And then finally, understanding this, what's education for? And Albert Einstein, in a wonderful book, much longer quote than on the screen, says, education is to widen our circles of compassion, to embrace all living creatures and the whole of nature and its beauty. And I would only add, over long periods of time. Thank you all very much. So if the Earth was in a cooling cycle, we stopped and we started to move the other direction. If it was in a warming cycle, we're accelerating. But your point is, your point's a good point, that it does flow. But there is no question scientifically now, and I've got a slide on this here deck on the computer, that shows that the actual consensus on climate change is around 99.9%. So if you get an ailment, you want to go to a doctor, you want to go to 0.1% of medical folks who believe that, you know, you can do this for you, or you want to go to the 99.9. That's kind of where we are now. But this is a, the thing that is so striking about our time is, and Roger Bell, who's a climate scientist, a very famous climate scientist, right afterwards, said that we're running a one-time experiment with the Earth. And whatever we do, we have no chance. If we're wrong, we won't. And so this is like playing, you know, you use your own metaphor, Russian roulette or whatever you want to do, but we have no chance. And it is not working out well. And that's not my opinion, that's all the scientists are doing. There really is no serious debate on the other side. There are some fringe debates about the effects of clouds and density of clouds and the rate of change and so forth. But there's not any correlations. But thanks for the question.
So what would be your first recommendation for small college like us to go towards in creating sustainability in our community around here as a college itself?
I'm trying to give you trouble, aren't you? Great. Good look. I'm out of here tomorrow, sometime around noon, so I can ride in the town and get people put ideas on the table. Your question's pretty good, but only you guys can answer them. Only you folks can really answer what do you want to do? And what should you know? You're going out here, it's been 4 years. And one of the curious things to me about higher education is how often and how passive you all are. You're buying a product. What do you want from us? One of the great classes I ever sat in on was when I was a grad student, Carl Rogers, a very famous psychologist, came in. And there were about this many people in the room. He was in a chair right there, and he said, nothing. He just looked at us. Pretty soon, people got very awkward and started looking down their shoes, and, you know, found something pretty interesting on the floor and they had overlooked. And so, finally, after about 5 or 10 minutes, he said, what do you want from me? And then it opened up one of the best classes I ever witnessed. And what happened in that class was extraordinary, but the burden was reversed. And the word education, if I take it apart, the word education, the root word is to educe, to draw forth. So what do you want from this? What would you want this university to be? And I think one of the dangers of this, once you pose the question, then you get this automatic thing, oh, the administration's all wrong. No, they're not. So what could you put together that includes the administration, faculty, and students? What can you come up with? One way to do this is to do what we did on the building. Have charrettes, design charrettes. What do you want the building to be like? What do you want the physical plan to be like? You'd find a awful lot of support. And you'd find that there are ways to get put together sustainability plans. The easy thing to do is the green buildings. It's important. I mean, you need to cut back your carbon footprint. Everybody needs to do it. And take your waste and buy it and so forth. That's the easy. The hardest part of sustainability is what I think. Because we're not really ready for this. On average, I am exposed, as you are, to 5,000 commercial messages a day. That's billboards, pop-ups, everything. That's the Nike swoosh on athletic equipment. That's all the stuff. We see 5,000 commercial advertisements in some form or other every day. And the largest effort ever made to reflect human consciousness, we're the product. If you don't know the name Edward Bernays, look him up. He was Sigmund Freud's nephew. And he started the largest advertising model for advertising companies. And he was very good at it. And he knew that you don't argue with the idea that some things be right or wrong. You don't argue rationality. You go down into the depths of what his Uncle Sigmund said was the id. You know, where all our lusts and 7 deadly sins reside. That's where you go. You want to sell something, you want to sell it because it's a good thing in the world. Not very much, not very often. And you don't sell things because this is really good for you. That's rational thinking. You sell because you're selling fear, lust, and greed, and envy. So you're selling the 7 deadly sins. So the point of this is, we've already been corrupted. And yet we're in an educational environment. If we can't address this here or locally, what are we talking about? Foreign countries? No way. Business corporations? It's got to be in places like this. when you think about sustainability, my recommendation is get to them, organize. They organize the faculty that care, you've got a lot of them here, administrators that care, you've got administrators that care a great deal here. They've got to make sure the bills get paid, you get educated, and so forth. So they've got responsibility to come together, do this as a community effort, and begin to develop your own plans. What we did at Oakland is Oakland specific. Is it working? No. I mean, I constantly complain about stuff that's going on my campus. I'm trying to push, I'm trying to show. Do your own here. But think long term and be a systems thinker. And in the middle of this, have fun. You know, have a party or two. Make it a celebration of life. Because that's what degree is all about. And so how do you reorient the university to life? Thanks for the question. That was a great question. Thanks.
With the upcoming COP21 talks in Paris, and you mentioned that the head of the UN framework was basically saying that the commitments that have been made today are overshooting the target of at least 2 degrees centigrade. I understand that we really shouldn't go beyond 1.5 degrees centigrade, which it sounds like it's probably already too late for even attempting that. How would we know, as advocates, that we've hit the target in December? What should we be asking for in terms of the commitments that the United States should be making in terms of greenhouse gases?
Boy, it's a good question. Did all of you hear this? It's not the commitments for greenhouse gases. We're up here debating aggregate numbers. Three thoughts. One is carbon, the atmosphere doesn't give a hoot about where the emissions come from. So carbon dioxide released in Africa, China, the United States, it doesn't matter. It all just goes up the atmosphere. It's all just one big atmosphere. Second comment is this. In 2008, we organized an effort called the President's Climate Action Plan. And I worked for the foundation. We helped to fund it and get it going. And we brought in 200 some scientists and policymakers, including John Holdren, who is President Obama's science advisor. And the goal was to put together for the next president of the United States, be a Democrat or Republican, a 100-day climate plan. And the idea was very simply to say that time's not your friend. Climate change is a central issue. It's not just an item on a list. It's the linchpin that holds the whole list together. Get that right, you'll be able to solve a lot of other things. And we put that together. It didn't have an effect at that time, although we stayed engaged with the White House, and I think later, in the second administration, it's had more effect. But what's occurring now? I started to say this because John Holdren is saying, I asked John, why 2 degrees centigrade is what they were calling the guardrail? And if we violate the guardrail, what happens? And John became very emotional. He's not a terribly emotional person in my experience with him. He didn't want to answer the question. He said, you don't want to know. And so the projections are, it gets nasty. The longer we delay, the warmer it will get, and the nastier things will become. And there is a point of no return. Of course, this Russian roulette thing, once we've heated the planet to we release methane from either oil forests or methane clathrates and seabeds. Game's over. We wouldn't survive. We see a spike in temperature, and there are geologic instances, 1, 2, or 3 million years ago, and reportedly, this is how it happened. So that 2 degrees centigrade threshold is not a trivial. If you were to poll most scientists now, almost every week, there's another major study published in Geophysical Letters or Science or whatever. And they're almost always, I would say virtually always, bad news. It's worse than we thought. And so there is every reason for urgency. And there is every reason for a house cleaning in Congress and in the courts with people who understand this issue. We paid a big price for scientific illiteracy in Congress. I'm off on a tangent here, but if you get a driver's license, you have to go take an exam, you go to work, and you have to know something. But you can drive a country without knowing anything about the ecological rules of the road. And you can drive us over cliffs. You've got to understand how the world works physically, and then you recalibrate. That's not a Republican or Democratic argument. Because Republicans used to be really good on this issue. Very good on this issue. But anyway, the 2 degrees centigrade target. The best thinking now is that if we are able to hold this down, what's taking place across the whole world is a disaggregated, what's called polycentric approach. And so it's colleges and universities begin to cut partnerships. It's corporations. It's whole cities. There's now a vast movement of big cities organized by the climate initiatives to reduce carbon emissions. And they're finding all kinds of ways to do it. But they're waiting for the federal government to pass cap and trade or a carbon tax, which would be very helpful at some point. But in the meantime, there are literally thousands of organizations worldwide moving on this. And not only the U.S., it's Europe, it's India, it's China, it's all over. And so the reason for optimism, in some sense, for this, or hopefully this, is that people are already moving on this. If I had stood up here 10 years ago and said there is a global movement on climate change, I would have blown smoke. 2015, that global movement is alive, it's well. Join it. You're a student. Join that movement in some form or fashion. You need to align your life and career and ambitions and talents with that movement to have a better life and a lot of people. But the issue of 2 degrees centigrade, if we are to stay below that, or to quickly get back below 400 parts per million down to 390 and so forth, it's going to be because CIT University, Logan College, corporations, cities, towns, farmers, individual people begin to cut their own carbon emissions. This is a massive bottom-up effort. And then that is not to say that we don't need something up here. A carbon tax would be very helpful, along with a number of other things. That's the subject of my next book. But that would be very, very helpful. But 2 degrees centigrade probably is too much. And we're going to have to figure out how, if we cross that threshold, how to quickly get back down and lower carbon emissions. But in the meantime, we can get a lot of lunch. But thanks. Thanks.
So,
thank you.
Okay. I'm glad I mentioned Interface because it's actually the company that shifted my career goals for the purpose of sustainability. And I'm working on, I'm looking at the foundation and the same for our main project right now, actually. But my question is, if there are so many corporations successfully making a business case for sustainability, is it just the sheer fear of change that's preventing other companies from making this change?
You know, lurking in this question, thanks for lurking in this question is capitalism up to it? Could you imagine a sustainable capitalist society? And let me tell you what the options are. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I think, yeah, probably could be if, perhaps, maybe on Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, I say, no way, no how, Sunday, I rest. So, you know, Ray Anderson, founder of Interface, I've been friends over the last 20 years of life, and Ray told me one day on the telephone conversation, he said, David, he was with Georgia, he's one of the wonderful son of an accident, David, it's lonely out here. And he was the poster child for sustainable business activity. He was the guy I always cited about people like me and business. It just shows you what capitalism can do. It's more complicated than that, isn't it? Because if I take extractive industry, I spent a fair portion of the last decade fighting mountaintop removal in West Virginia. And the extractive industries are not going to go green easily. That's why ExxonMobil, that extractive industry, they don't produce oil. Basically extract. And your business plan calls again for them to burn all their reserves. Can you make them sustainable? Well, I don't know. A good bit of their asset base has got to be sequestered. They can't burn it or they fry your world. So how do you sequester that asset base? It's got to go from being an asset to being publicly sequestered. And the options are we could buy it. We could ante up billions of dollars, trillions of dollars, and buy their asset base. It's about $20-25 trillion. So we could buy it. We could confiscate it. Somebody take it over. How did they get ownership of this stuff? Or we could make it irrelevant. We could simply push solar power so fast we don't need their product. Let them keep it. Or turn it into something else. We could turn it into building materials or other things. The oil molecules is one of the most complicated. Complex molecules and one of the most useful molecules on the planet, so you can use it for other things. But I can't see them giving up willingly. And then there are all the advertising industry. We develop a growth economy. If I change the question just a little bit from could and can the economy continue to grow and expand as it has, say, for the past 75 years or sort of since 65 years on a finite planet? That raises a whole series of other issues. And then if it can expand, what do you do about the fact that income is so wildly concentrated at the top of the system, the people here in the South, the middle class and the poor? So, I mean, it raises, your question raises a whole nest of really tough issues. Thanks for raising it, by the way, but it raises these things that will divide us. There will be blood on the floor on some of these issues. Capitalism, and I think if you ask me, if you ask for a real honest answer, I'll give it to you now. The trend that we're going toward is the possibility of making a society sustainable, powered by sunshine, hyper-efficient, and fascist. You follow what I'm saying? So, if you look at over here at NSA, if you're on a cell phone, NSA filters, they understand every message you got. It's all being recorded. So, remember in 1984? They know what you do in ways that George Orwell never dreamed of. And this is where I can get on board with Rand Paul on the right. I think he's been right on that. They look at our lives in all kinds of ways. We spent $1.3 trillion on something we call defense. Could we break the defense budget? And capitalism depends a lot on that $1.3 trillion of buying weapons and airplane parts and all that kind of stuff. That's a driver in the capitalist society. But I can't see a sustainable society as a little tiny island in this sea of a culture war system. I don't see it. And it's a system that has to have wars to survive. It isn't just there war, there's outside threats. We help to create some of those threats, not all of them, not all at one time. But we're not innocent in this process of global conflict. But we are loath to say that. We keep calling ourselves, you know, God's gift to the planet. We're no such thing. We're a particular band of Homo sapiens that landed on a continent here that was pretty much untapped. And we lived on the soils and the wealth, the natural wealth of this particular country. We did pretty well. We got a lot of good trade. We've done a lot of good things in the world. But we've done some things we're not so proud of. And so how does that system mesh? How do we make a just economy? And this was the brunt. Pope Francis and Sicily. Read it carefully. This is what it's about. You cannot make war against people. And in a lot of ways, the environmental movement is simply because we made war against the natural world. We thought we could dominate the whole world, and that's what the problem was. We got out there, we bulldozed this, our agriculture is terribly aggressive, machine dominated and so forth. And I come out of kind of a farming town, grew up and loved farming and operated a farm for a while. But the way we do farming, the way we do transportation, the way we do a lot of things is pretty violent. How do you make peace with the natural world? That's what Mondato say was about. This isn't easy stuff, but it's easier than not. It's easier than being a procrastinator. But your question is right at the heart of the problem. How do we earn our keep? How do we feed ourselves, provision ourselves with food, energy, water, materials, entertainment, all these things that we buy and we come. How do we do that in a way that doesn't destroy the earth? And that is the question for our time. It can be said much better than I just said, but that in some form or fashion, that is the question of our time. And whether you like it or not, whether you believe this stuff or not, it's going to hit you right between the white lines. It's going to hit you in the face. This is the issue of our time. We're running out of clean air, we're running out of climate resilience. And are there solutions? I think there are. I think Ray Anderson was part of it. He was pioneering a whole new business model. If I make it, I don't want it to go to a landfill and compromise where we're going to stay there for 40,000 years. And I don't want to take the Saudi Arabian crude. So the carpet in the Lewis Center you saw here goes back to Interface. We're done with it. They come, they take it, they strip it apart, they remake it into a new product, it never goes to a landfill. Now, what that means, if I've got chemistry majors here, what that means is he was hired chemistry majors who understood how you put molecules together the way they can be taken apart and reused. That's pretty cool. But imagine that business model applied as the Germans try to, or have done, that business model applied to, say, Ford Motor Company, or General Motors, or car manufacturer generally. You make it, you own it in the world. And you've got to figure out how to take that thing apart and reuse it. Right? But you own it. Imagine that applied. like the solvents, the petrochemical business. Once you make it, you own it forever. Imagine, you got responsibility, so we can now track stuff. If you emit carbon, there are ways to track carbon chemically by the way you make carbon molecules. So if you put it up there, you own it. You're responsible. But imagine a world like that. But imagine a better world powered by sunshine, efficiency, and the concept of sufficiency. That we have, and one of these ends up just on a roll here. We have, you know, this is when I was in grad school, 30 years ago, there were studies of happiness that showed that happiness peaked about 1957. So we had all this stuff for happiness, our happiness, or our reported happiness peaked. We all got kind of bored. So the amount of stuff we had went up like this. And so it's that gap between this, the stuff, and our happiness level that you got to explain. And that is one of the great ironies that hangs over the growth economy. Economists don't like to talk about it. So we all know that. Happiness comes from our relationships and so forth, and better poetry leagues and baseball leagues, and the stuff that we do together, good meals together, and friends, and so on. We all know that stuff. Beyond a certain low level, happiness is not about this stuff. But we bought into a world where we think that we can do without it. I think the great power of democracy is it said we have to create a world together. And if you count the number of times the word integral is used, it just means divided in. But that is also the root meaning of religion. So anyway, thanks for the question. Sorry for the long-winded ramble here. It's a hot question. Any other last pressing issues for you? Yeah. Solar collector, all those windmills, all that green building stuff I showed here, all it does is to buy us time. And for a species that calls itself Homo sapiens, if we were really wise creatures, we would put that time to use to solve deeper problems. Who are we? What are we as a species? What do we want to be when we grow up as a species? That's what we would do. But you're asking fine print questions. I'm going to drive out of here on asphalt roads. I'll be driving a Prius, which itself has environmental problems. And it takes a lot of stuff to make a Prius, but it burns less gas. Is it a net thing? Winter? Don't know. Smart people might have figured that out. But I'll be driving on asphalt roads. That's all we can deal with. And we're back to a motel that is anything but green. We'll leave a carbon footprint in the atmosphere. We can have Prius. And so there just is a lot of problems. And your question begs us to become really good accountants and not pass, not sweep across under the rug anymore. So the scaffold on which we want to build a sustainable society, could you make a solar-powered society that released no waste product that generated enough power to regenerate or reconstitute itself? That's an issue. And right now, I don't think you'd find 1,000 people on Earth that would believe that is right now possible to me. And I'm not sure I can do that. But it buys us time. Thanks for that question. Any other last minute? Hey, you've been a great audience. Well, yeah, go ahead.
You said that the ecological crisis was a money crisis. How can you change someone who chose to achieve financial success to choose over a sustainable philosophy? change someone's mind.
All right, this will take us to midnight then. Well, in part, you're in a mind-changing part of your life now. You're in education. And some of the changes will be sudden. You'll have a bingo in class. I didn't know that. That's kind of cool. Some will be slow. Some seeds will be planted in your own head. It will be, it will grow and multiply 20 years after. But the models for mind change are interesting. St. Paul had a road to Damascus conversion. Bingo. So I'm different. Jesus taught me. Some people go on wilderness trips, and they never see the world the same again. Some people have near-death experiences. They go to the point of death, some just across the line, and they come back and they're very different people. Some people will reason themselves into a different mindset. The thing that you've got to avoid is to be mindless about this. I don't know how to change somebody's mind. And I talk to people, I write books and so forth. But I don't know how to change people's minds that aren't already open to change. But the point of an education isn't to arrive at a certain right view, set of views. The point of education is to begin to learn how to use that thing between your ears, to think, actually think. It's the hardest work you'll ever do, but it's the most rewarding work you'll ever do. Be a lifelong reader. Understand things. Ask questions. And then when you hear something new or different, you know, to be able to mull it over. And what Mary Bishop, one of the wisest educators I've ever read, she wrote a book on why smartness isn't enough. I thought that was kind of interesting because the smart kids I've known as students make great returns. They get the answer quick, they study stuff. The wise students, however, sit there with a problem, complex problem, sustainability. If there's ever a problem that's complex, it's sustainability. And they'll mull it over, think about it, and they'll get the right answer. And the right answer took mulling over. That is a valuable skill. Stay at it, be a person that mulls stuff over. Change people's minds. People ask sometimes, you know, my dad just doesn't understand sustainability. Argue all the time. No, don't. You know, love your dad, love your parents. There's some people you don't want to argue with. That's advice I would give. Don't always follow it, maybe. But find probably the best thing you can do is just be yourself. If you want to change people's minds, live it out first. And then let the chips fall in. Some will change, some will change. I wouldn't worry about it. And I don't much argue with people about climate change, just at the start of the time. Yeah, the science has been done for a long time. But what we need now is fewer people with the right answers and more people with clear convictions and character. And so take time to build it. It takes a lifetime. That's, for most of us, that's still not enough. But keep at it. Don't worry about changing things. Do what you want to do. One last comment on this. Something like 70% of our sensory apparatus is connected to our eyes. So we tend to believe what we see. The verse is also probably true. We tend to kind of believe, see what we believe, but that's another issue. So do things that are visible. When we did the Lewis Center, I could have gone to our faculty and said, hey, there's a subject called ecological design, and you need to study this, you need to design all the buildings differently. The best I would have hoped for is to be different. The best I could hope for would be some faculty committee set up to study ecological design. What's that? But we did the building. It's there. Not perfect, but it's there, and it works. And so there's a model. You can see it, feel it, touch it, experience it. We have classes in it, but we've had weddings and funerals in it. It's there. It's a model. So make what you do visible. If you want to go to farming, make that one heck of a good farm. If you want to create a business that really works. Want to be an architect or builder, make that work, make it work well. Want to be a writer or a sport, weave it in, make people see what you do. Okay? Thanks for the questions. A terrible answer, but the question is pretty great. Keep asking.
So we have a little reception outside from those of you who want to mingle a little bit longer around. I also want to already introduce our next speaker, who we have invited for April. That will be Justin Mork. I think you know him. He said he was a student of yours. Justin Mork, who is the sustainable officer of Louisville University, the University of Louisville in Kentucky, and he will speak here in April 6th and 7th. So, and thank you again, and enjoy our